Madras. They're doing some fantastic work. And over to you, Doctor.
Thank you. By the time that he uploads the presentation, maybe we can have a discussion on whatever we are doing in the center. So just to give you a brief on what the Center for Battery Engineering and Electric Vehicle does. As the name specifies, it in fact clarifies that we are an R&D organization which does R&D on battery engineering, and we do subsystems of electric vehicles. Now when we say battery engineering, we do battery designing, starting from battery management system, its characterization, testing, thermal management, vibrations, and all taken into account, and do battery designs for two-wheelers, three-wheelers, cars, buses, etc. And do it both for fixed applications and swappable applications. And when it comes to the subsystems of EVs, we do motors, motor controllers. Especially whenever we are doing all these things, anyways, you would say that these are all available. So what is it that we do? Our effort is Make in India, and we do all these products specially suitable for Indian environment in a way that all these systems could be procured, manufactured in the country at affordable prices, but not compromising the performances. So the aim and the target that we, in which we start the design, is attaining the efficiency and the best performance that is available globally, and if possible exceed, and do it in a way that we monitor everything, manage everything, and optimize everything. To do that, when we started, we were about 5 people, and we are now a team of 130 people who are focused on development and research on all these segments. And just how we are different from many of the other R&D homes in the country is that we are not doing fundamental R&D. So what we focus is on develop the product and commercialize. So what we do is we transfer the technology to many companies, and we have done that to about 5-6 companies now in last 3 years. And all the work that we do it along with the startups. So there are about 9 startups who are nurtured inside C-BEEV, and who are also very, I would say that they contribute immensely towards whatever we design. So for example, for batteries, Nikhilesh is here, there's a team from GreenTech that does a lot of work around the batteries. And then we have a company, Flowtrick, that does on the charger. We have Esmito, who does a whole monitoring and battery optimization and a lot of asset management from the whole ecosystem. So we have a lot many companies in the IIT ecosystem. We have about 200 startups, but when we talk about the center in itself, we have about 9 companies with whom we are closely working on. I think I had already summarized. To go through my presentation, I thought that many of people would be going here about their commercial products, what they have and what the features are. I thought that I would focus much on what are the technology interventions for EV roadmap, considering that where we are now and what we need to do from different domains concerning batteries and electric vehicles. So we all know the different subsystems that we need to make in India are batteries, vehicles, chargers, and the infrastructure setup that takes care of users, the other actors like drivers and different operators. So when we talk about all these, some segments, some in parts would be existing globally, and some would be very different from Indian perspective. So if we talk about the whole of it, the idea is that understanding the need, the very first basic thing that starts where our engineering starts is understanding the requirements. So first step to design starts from gathering the requirements and understanding how are we different. For example, the way we drive, the speeds at which we drive, the traffic patterns that we have are very different from the countries where the EVs have already happened. Be it Germany, US, other European countries, Sweden, and even China. So all their road conditions, our road conditions, and the traffic we have and the speed at which we drive, they're very, very different. So understanding needs, design, develop, monitor whatever we are developing. When we do pilots, monitor and learn, redesign, go to the board, back to the board and redesign and find faults in your own design to have a better product in the future and optimize the performance and utilization. So if we start from an EV, the things that we have differently, that need to be differently done as far as an IC engine is concerned is one, the powertrain technology, which includes motors, controllers, MCU, battery technology and charging technology. Now when it comes to motors, probably we do not have any Indian motor manufacturer, could be a couple of those that are starting now, but not many that who are doing motors for electric vehicles in the country. So far whatever we are getting, that is even for two wheelers and three wheelers, which are probably about 80% of our total automobile vehicles, and when we talk about the vehicles that are electric in nature, then considering the last year's data, the two wheelers and three wheelers are 94% of the total vehicles sold in the country. So if you look at all those vehicles, imagine the amount of motors and the controllers that we are importing. So this is one key area where we need to design our own motors better and manufacture them in-house. Batteries, we do not have any other alternative manufacture the cells. Currently, we do not have the cells, the technology, and a few of the people like C-CREI, ISRO are trying to get that done. But I think right now we do not have, and we have to rely on the imports. But what is the low-hanging fruit is that we can make our own battery packs in-house. And then the charging technology. This, I guess, is somewhat similar to what is already existing in IC engines-based vehicles also. And if we look at the capability for electronics domains, we have good engineers available who can design all these. And apart from that, the telematics and the frames and the complete architecture almost remains the same. Or if we have the expertise, we can redesign the same thing for EVs. What differs is the expectations from the EV. We do not expect a lot from IC-based vehicles these days. But when it comes to electric vehicles, we want to see a lot of variations. We want to see a lot of connectivity. We want to see a lot of intelligence imbibed into the vehicle and see that what all we can do with that vehicle. That is the telematics and the IT part that comes into the vehicle. Now, when we see about this, we need to see that what is the value creation that we can do. So when we started to understand that what and where we need to focus on our engineering and development efforts, we looked at the losses that we incur currently in the vehicles. So if we talk about EV propulsion system, the majority of the losses that happen out of the total junk come from the motor and the drive unit. Batteries do not cause losses. What cause losses are the motors and the drive unit. And if we look at the cost, the batteries are the costliest part in the vehicle. That is almost, so this is as per a cumulative study. So when we engineer it, the whole of the effort that goes is into actually the battery design, which is about 75% of the cost. So what we require? Two things. Engineering that can be done for the cost, and engineering that we can do for the losses. That means bringing in high efficiency and bringing that efficiency at right costs. That means bringing the electric vehicle at an affordable price, because affordability is a key in the country. So what we need to have to build the EV subsystems: drivetrains, converters, electrically driven power steering, brakes, air conditioning system, battery packs and battery cells, we'll come to that in a couple of slides later. And then materials that go in all over across this whole EV and the subsystem. Then of course the vehicle controller software and integration. Now if we look at lithium ion battery chemistry option, I won't spend much time on this though, since Mr. Manikandan had already explained, and I'm sure Dr. Rahul would have explained that in much detail in the morning session. Just to bring out that where we have to go is that higher and higher energy density. But remember, as and when we are going into higher energy density, we are focused or we are moving towards creating bombs. So what is required, what is expected out of engineering is that to manage those bombs, not to explode. So the whole effort that we have to do is on the safety, on the management, and doing it all the way very well. So that is where we started with two-wheelers and three-wheelers, understanding and learning from them, and simultaneously work on how do we build packs for buses and trucks, wherein the whole of the technology can be done in-house and we do not have to import anything. So if we go look at that, even if we look at China, we have very, very good targets to achieve higher and higher energy density. So if you look at the table, and when we talk to number of people, we say that LFP is the most safe and probably we should go ahead with that. But if you look at what the China sets and where is the LFP standing, probably that is not the future way we should be looking at. What probably is the answer for the battery chemistry in the country is the NMC graphite or NCA, and the best right now suitable for the chemistry for the batteries is NMC, and that is what we had been focusing on. So battery materials, as I told, probably is 40% of the total cost in a battery. Cell manufacturing another 30%. So if we see for the total value of the battery, 70% is gone because we do not have the battery material, we do not have the cell manufacturing happening in the country, so we cannot actually do anything about it. But what is a low hanging fruit here? The low hanging fruit is the cell to pack design. And if we can do that nicely, that is what is would be termed as make in India. For the time being. So that is what we need to start developing indigenously. Before we go to what kind of batteries do we require, again we work with an organization, World Resource Institute, that needs no introduction. So we kind of did a lot of analysis around a number of parameters that should be considered before we start to design on it, and look at what we found is on the trip lengths. If we look at the average trip length in the country, 71% of the trips are of less than 5 kilometers. 16% of the trips are of the length greater than 10 kilometers. But what we talk about is the range, and what we get impressed by is the 450 kilometers, 600 kilometers of the announcements that come with BMW and Teslas and all such companies. But if we look at what is required in the country, is very, very different. So what do we need to focus on is, if we are talking about EVs and faster adoption of EVs, is the smaller batteries that we can create. Therefore, what we started to look at was the low cost, looking at the trends and what are the demands, what are the statistics that are telling us that is a requirement of the India, and we started to look at the smaller batteries, which is about 98% of the vehicles in the country, and that is a very unique feature that we have, which is not been done by anyone else. So if we have to do something for our country, it has to be focused on the masses, what the masses require, and that technology we need not import. This is something that we need to do for our own people. And then doing things with some innovative approaches. So you'll ask, what do we do for the premium cars? I think there are enough companies who would do and worry about premium cars, and there are Teslas of the world who would be any day exporting it to India, and there'll be people who can afford, they'll be buying it. So even when it comes to subsidy, we often talk that subsidy is not required on the electric vehicles which are in premium segment. Somebody who can pay 80 lakhs, he can pay 90 lakhs also. So he doesn't require subsidy. Who requires subsidy are the masses, where we talk about two-wheelers and three-wheelers. And we talk about small segment vehicles, like the vehicles that the medium class people buy for about 7 lakhs, 8 lakhs. And if we have subsidy there and it doesn't let the vehicle price go up to 15 lakhs or 20 lakhs, that's where we require the faster proliferation of electric vehicles. Now, when it comes to designing the batteries, what do we require? Right cell selection? Considering that chemistry, life cycles, charge discharge, operation conditions, and depending upon the application, what is the right cell? So what do we do is characterize the cell, and based upon that application, we select that cell. We need good algorithms that take care of number of things, discharge and charge optimally, keep observing what is required by the battery life, and accordingly take a call. Do mechanical designs robustly, protect them, and protect them means all the safety features that could be incorporated into the battery. And then thermal management for cooling. I'm sure Nikhilesh will be talking a little more about how the battery considerations are taken into account. And then the master that comes, that's the brain behind all of this that manages, is the battery management system. When we come to the chargers, we have a number of chargers like standalone chargers, slow chargers, fast chargers, and a lot of categorization, and the infrastructure needs that are being talked about, and the FAME incentives and subsidies that are talked about. What I would request everyone is that before we decide for taking the charger and putting up in a public place, we need to worry about, is that what is required by the public? Am I putting a charger which would be used and utilized? Look at the statistics. The results show whatever public infrastructure has been created by Germany or US, the public chargers utilization has not been more than 16%. Are we wanting to create the same infrastructure with the public's money, and would that be utilized in the country? Given that those chargers are compatible to the cars that they have, how many Teslas and BMWs we have here, and for them do we need to have those public chargers, or we need to have the public chargers for the vehicles, for the kind of vehicles that we are going to buy, that the Indians are going to buy? So what are the types of the public chargers that we need to invest? What is the infrastructure we would want to create? So then we have the bulk chargers, probably not happening there, and is something very unique here. Bulk chargers is something that in the last session, Sun Mobility and Ashok Leland was talking about. So the charger that can charge multiple batteries in one go, be it the bus chargers, that means bus batteries, or the two-wheelers and three-wheelers chargers. Now, as I said, that there are a number of companies that are working with us. There is a company named Flowtrick, which designs these bulk chargers and also does a number of home chargers and AC slow chargers. And we had been doing some pilots along with a number of startups that we have, and with a number of energy operators that came to us, about three of the energy operators with whom we had done pilots in Chennai and Mohali, and we are soon going to go in Hyderabad. So coming to the charging architecture, which is the last leg of the complete ecosystem, there's two architectures only that are possible. One is a public architecture, that is a charging architecture, another is a swapping architecture. Without spending much time on what public architecture is, we are doing different pieces in the complete architecture and figuring out that in that architecture, what do we need to change to make it compatible to the Indian needs, and is there something that needs to be tweaked, and what are the software pieces, what are the hardware pieces that we could design in the country, and we have done a lot of work around that. If we talk about the swapping, in the last segment we were talking about that these are not standardized. So what we started was an effort along with about 35 companies where we started this forum on swapping, and we iterated on it probably about 25-30 times to figure out what should be there as a swapping architecture and how do we manage that. So if we see that, we came up with what we call as Log Smart Vehicle Battery Charger Cloud Protocol, around which the whole architecture, different protocols from different legs of the whole ecosystem were defined, and they have been adopted by a number of companies now, and they are putting them and we are helping them to import all those things into the system. Of course, that takes time for standardization and it has not been standardized yet, but yes, our effort is into that we can get the alignment from the industry that needs, I mean, we require a lot of support, and it is not that we defined it, so this has to be adopted. No, it's very open to all the industries, and this is how we are trying to work as an independent party, that everyone who is wanting to be in this system for the benefit of our society and the public at large, we need to come together, debate on it, that this is needed, not needed, and we are open to iterate on it, and this is very much available on our website as an open protocol, and anyone can download, suggest changes, and this is what we are trying to take to the BIS also and see that how we can go for standardization using the same or iterating on it or whatever different changes we need to make on it. So whatever we do, we monitor them onto the cloud. So all these sub-segments are connected together, and we do a lot of optimization onto that. Be it the EV infrastructure management from the battery point of view, chargers, vehicles, or users, we try to capture a lot of it and do optimization. And this is done with one of our companies named Esmito, which offers some SaaS-based platforms to the company. And this is a B2B platform. So the company doesn't go to the customers directly, but they help the business entities to import make use of the platform, which comes as pluggable modules there, and performs a lot of data analytics onto that. This is a sample analytics from the battery. So there's a battery analyzer, which captures lots of data going to each cell. So of course that depends upon how much battery is allowing us to monitor and how much of the communication is inbuilt into the battery also, how smart is the battery. If that allows, we capture a lot of data and do a lot of analytics, and we categorize the batteries as per their goodness. That means it's good to go, it's giving some alerts or safety, there's something that the user himself can do to correct the battery, or do we need to send the battery for maintenance, or the battery is, there's time now for the retirement of the battery or recycling of the battery. So all these cases are considered, and we bring in some insightful dashboards onto it. So what we do is we monitor, optimize, control and optimize, and this goes as a very this goes as a circle for giving feedback to each of the processes. The aim is the asset optimizations. So in the last session also we were talking about asset optimization and getting value out of that asset, and the safety part as well. So this all is taken care of, and this is the basis of getting this analytics engine done. Lots of reports for different stakeholders, and trying to get the best ROI out of all the assets that are put into that, and generating different what we say is the advisories to the stakeholders for their designing, for their business, for their restructuring the whole model. So the conclusion is that EVs is gaining momentum, and probably there's nobody who can stop it. We have all to work together that it goes in the right direction, in a direction where we want it to be taken. And we do it in such a way that we can make it in India, try to protect whatever jobs we can, bring in our own ecosystem ourselves, and especially start doing it with two-wheelers and three-wheelers. And I believe the startups have a very great role to play. And I hope that everything in the ecosystem starts getting manufactured in India. Let's work together, and feeling excited about it. Thank you.